U.S. military assistance from a multi-billion-dollar aid bill passed by Congress last month already on the ground in Ukraine. That assurance coming from the White House, which says there will be a steady flow of weapons to Kyiv.
The same day that the law took effect, now 2-3 weeks ago, the president signed out a billion-dollar package. Some of that equipment is already on the battlefield. On Friday, he signed out another package. Some of that equipment will get onto the battlefield this week. Now, some of it has a longer lead time in terms of our ability to ship it, organize it, and get it in.
As part of a $95 billion security package, the U.S. Congress authorized $60.8 billion worth of various forms of aid to Ukraine. The White House pledged to get the weapons into Ukraine swiftly. Now, the United States not viewing the killings of Palestinians by Israel in its war with Hamas as genocide. White House National Security Advisor Jake Sullivan, however, says they believe Israel can do more to ensure the safety of innocent civilians. He adds the U.S. continues to talk to Israel about ensuring their military operations have a clear strategic endgame to secure the future of Palestinians in Gaza.
We do not believe what is happening in Gaza is a genocide. We have been firmly on record rejecting that proposition. Military pressure is necessary, but not sufficient to fully defeat Hamas. If Israel's military efforts are not accompanied by a political plan for the future of Gaza and the Palestinian people, the terrorists will keep coming back and Israel will remain under threat.
Gaza's health ministry updates its breakdown of fatalities in the seven-month war after questions were raised by Israel. The United Nations, which regularly cites the ministry's figure, says the breakdown now reflects nearly 25,000 people who have been fully identified. The death toll, though, remains at more than 35,000.
The Ministry of Health says that the documentation process of fully identifying details of the casualties is ongoing. Meanwhile, as you can see if you do the math, that there's about another 10,000 plus bodies who still have to be fully identified. And so then the details of those, which of those are children, which of those are women, that will be reestablished once the full identification process is complete.
Israel last week questioned why figures for the death of women and children were suddenly halved. In a podcast, Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu says the overall toll is lower compared to the figures given by Palestinian authorities. He adds almost half of those killed are Hamas fighters. Now, Donald Trump's former fixer, Michael Cohen, takes the stand in the former U.S. president's hush money trial. Cohen told jurors Trump personally signed off on the payment to adult film star Stormy Daniels to bury her story about an alleged sexual encounter before it could derail his 2016 campaign. Prosecutors have said Trump paid Cohen back after the election and hid the reimbursement by recording it falsely as a legal retainer fee. Trump's lawyers have argued that Cohen acted on his own, a notion he rejected on the witness stand. Trump faces 34 counts of falsifying business documents or records tied to the payment. Let's find out what stories our North America Bureau is pursuing right now from our Bureau Chief, TJ Manotok.
Good morning to the friends of the Rundown. Here are the top stories making the headlines in the North American region.
A Filipino mother of two in Tucson, Arizona, is getting out of jail after she was charged with putting poison in her husband's coffee. 40-year-old Melody Johnson, who agreed to a plea deal on April 8th, to two counts of adding a harmful substance to food and drink, which were captured on home surveillance cameras, has been sentenced to 3 years probation. Her husband, Robbie Johnson, spoke to the judge before the sentencing.
Period of incarceration may have imparted valuable lessons. I harbor doubts that it alone will address the underlying issues. Hence, I respectfully petition that Melody be mandated to undergo mental health treatment and educational programs in concert with probation.
Melody's attorney, Antea Gatalica, told the court that the Filipina has taken responsibility for her actions.
She has, as indicated by the pre-sentence report, apologized to the victim, Robbie Johnson. She makes no excuse for her conduct, and that was in her letter to the court.
Besides a 3-year probation, Melody was ordered to undergo mental health treatment. Melody, who was in the process of divorcing her husband, already spent nearly a year in jail while waiting for her case to be concluded. Speaking of mental health, according to the Worldwide Mental Health Foundation, Mental illness affects an estimated 950 million people worldwide and is the leading cause of disability across all age groups. Filipino-American Juan Montero, a retired physician, says that while the U.S. government has done initiatives to address mental health problems, there are still gaps, and the marginalized and underserved communities are falling through the cracks. Montero established the internationally renowned Montero Medical Missions, which recently collaborated with United Community Solutions, a Chesapeake-based behavioral and mental care provider. The cooperation aims to improve access to mental and behavioral health care services to those in need, just in time for Mental Health Awareness Month this May.
We can here put together something innovative, something never been done in this country, for getting the psychiatrists, psychologists, social workers, and especially counseling services to work together, put our heads together so that behavioral health challenges can be addressed.
And finally, in entertainment news, original Filipino music icon Odette Quezada's all-hits 40th anniversary concert made its way through California during a very festive Mother's Day weekend with back-to-back jam-packed shows in Glendale's Alex Theater and the Fox Theater in Redwood City. A live band and special guests, Raymond Lauchenco, Jaya, and Felsen Palad, all made for an anniversary extravaganza. The opening act also included the Garcia twins, fresh from their The Voice stint on NBC.
Truly grateful and I'm ecstatic about the response to the show, and hopefully we get to do this in other parts of the states.
Fans came from far and wide to catch the OPM singer-songwriter, and her songs took them down through memory lane. This concert, produced through a collaboration with Crossover Events, AIP Media, and the Filipino Channel, is part of the celebration of the year-long anniversary of TFC.
And those are the top stories making the headlines in the North American region. You can catch more of our TFC News on our website, news.abs-cbn.com/TFC News, and head on over to the ABS-CBN News YouTube channel. I'm TJ Manotok. Back to our friends at the Rundown.